Father, now, we thank you for the gift of marriage. But more than that, we thank you for the gift of Christ. God, I just come to you right now, and I thank you for this opportunity. Lord, this is the day of celebration for Adam and Sarah. I pray right now that you would calm nerves and anxiety, that you would let things go smoothly from here on out, that there would be no hiccups in anything to Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated. Welcome again, guys. This is just such a momentous occasion, and I know that Adam and Sarah, both of you guys, are excited. And let's everybody just take a deep breath right now and just enjoy the moment. Because what you guys don't know is over the last several months, these two have come in regularly on Sunday afternoons, and we have talked about stuff. Probably if you're here, there's a good chance your name might have even came up in some of our premarital counseling, and I know some good stuff about some of you. But we have had some good times together. We've talked about some hard things together. We talked about some awkward things together. But all of it was leading to this day. Because this day is that day where the two of you are celebrating your love for one another. And I'm so glad that all of you are here to join them in that celebration. Over the last several months, we have talked specifically about the foundation of marriage. And you guys already know this, and the reason we covered it in such detail is because today, you're not going to remember a thing I say. So, a lot of this is for everybody else that's here, but I just want to make sure that everybody knows we talked about the foundation of any marriage has to be on Christ. It has to be on that truth of the gospel that God, the creator of us all, He sent His Son to die for us even while we were still in a rebellious state. And we respond in faith and repentance to that offer of salvation. The reason that is the foundation of marriage is because in Ephesians chapter 5, we are commanded, Adam, you are to love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave Himself for her. If you don't understand exactly how Christ gave Himself for you and for your wife, you'll never be able to love her the way that God designed you to love her. And Sarah, you are called as a wife to love your husband by submitting to him as the church submits to Christ. Again, if you don't understand that truth of the gospel, you'll never be able to love your husband as God has designed you. So I think it's fitting, the passage that you actually asked me to read is the one that we will spend the large majority of our time in. And the passage they asked me to read was 1 Corinthians chapter 13. It's a passage that you probably all are very familiar with. But I'm going to give you some context of it. In Corinthians, Paul is writing this letter to a church who is broken, a church who is messed up and marred by sin. He goes on to paint the picture, the only way that a church can be healthy is if it is built on the unity of Christ. And from that, he then goes on to this glorious chapter that is used in so many occasions like this. I think the imagery that's there fits so well within the course of what we do here, because as we come together, we all realize you guys are two sinners who are saying, I do. You're two broken people who are coming together. And the only way that this works is if you are bound together under the unity of Christ. So with that in mind, Paul addresses the church and tells them how they are to relate to one another. And the same truth that he talks about to the church is the same that starts in your home, the building block of the church. And 1 Corinthians 13 says, if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels that have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have all prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. I want to stop right there after those first three verses. What this shows us is that without love, all our efforts amount to nothing. Guys, that's so true in marriage, because you can do all the right things, but if you have a wrong motivation in doing them, if it is not for the love of your spouse, it profits nothing. He goes on to say, love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Without action, love is nothing. when you look at these verses, you see Paul switches from this idea about our efforts to speaking specifically about our actions. One of the exercises you guys remember vividly that we did in our premarital counseling was when we took that section and we filled in your name. Let's do it right now. Adam is patient. Sarah is patient and kind. Sarah does not envy. Adam does not envy or boast. They are not arrogant or rude. They do not insist on their own way. They are not irritable or resentful. Adam and Sarah does not rejoice at the wrongdoing, but they rejoice with the truth. Adam and Sarah bears all things. They believe all things. They hope in all things. They endure all things. I know as we do that, and that's a challenge even for you guys as a guest here, when you look at the standard of love, plug your name into where love is and see, are those things true? And I know Adam and Sarah were very truthful as we did that exercise, and they said, no, there are some things that, you know, that doesn't describe me to the fullest. I think if you're honest, you probably will say the same thing. If I'm honest, I will say the same thing. And if my wife is honest, she will say the same thing. Again, guys, marriage is not a fixed moment. This is but one moment in the day of the rest of your lives. You guys have the rest of your lives to continue working on those actions, those attitudes that aren't quite where you want them to be. Never stop growing in love. He finishes out this chapter with love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know even in part. Then I shall fully know, even as I have been fully known. So now, faith, hope, and love abide these three. But the greatest of these is love. Without love, permanence is fleeting. Here's the thing, everything in this life will pass away. The boutonnieres that we wear will wilt. The petals that were so expertly strewn as you came in, they will wilt away. Your dresses will tarnish. But truly, those loving memories that you guys make will last to generations that you will never know. And that's why we're here today. We're here to celebrate the beginning of that union that will impact generations upon generations. With that being said, we come to the part of our service where we exchange rings. May I have the rings?
You can put it on.
Thank you. Adam, let me give you Sarah's ring. Take that one. Do you take Sarah to be your lawfully wedded wife, to have and hold her from this day forward?
I do.
Put the ring on her left ring finger and please repeat after me. I, Adam. Take you, Sarah. To be my wife. And I promise before God. And all who are present here. To be your loving and faithful husband. As long as we both shall live. I will love you. And give myself up for you. As Christ loved the church. And gave himself up for her. I will serve you with tenderness and respect. Will love you through sickness and in health. Will encourage you to develop the gifts that God has given you. And look forward to serving Him alongside you. Sarah, take the ring Sarah, do you take Adam to be your lawfully wedded husband, to have and to hold from this day forward?
I do.
You will please place the ring on his left ring finger. And I will ask that you repeat after me. I, Sarah. Take you, Adam.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse. For richer, for poorer. In sickness and in health. To love and to cherish. As long as we both shall live. I pledge myself before God. And all who are present. With all my heart. To be your loving and faithful wife. I will love you. And submit to you. As the church loves and submits to the Christ. There we go. Sorry, got that one wrong. I will serve you with tenderness and respect. I vow to encourage you. To be the man that God has called you to be. And I promise to always glaze the cinnamon rolls.
I told you.
Family and friends and guests, we recognize that marriage is between a man and a woman. But we also recognize that marriage requires continual support and prayers. As a result, I want to ask you guys to commit to this couple. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to give a charge to you. And what I would ask you to do, if you are willing to do it at the conclusion of what I'm saying, I would like for you to respond with, "We will." So here's the charge that I give you. Will you, who witnessed this covenant between Adam and Sarah, respect their marriage and sustain them with your friendship, care, and prayers?
We will.
Thank you. At this time, Adam and Sarah will assemble the Unity Cross. It's a beautiful sculpture they will display in their home to remind them of the covenant that they are making. In Genesis chapter 1, we read that God created man in his own image. That means that he created man to be bold and strong and a leader, a protector of his wife and his family. So Adam, I want to go ahead and explain what this piece is. As we look at this outer piece of the cross, we see that it is a bold, strong outer edge of the cross. It's something that will protect the inside of the cross. Adam, I want you to take this. The outer form of this Unity Cross represents strength and leadership and protection of the man. The book of Ephesians reminds husbands that they are to love their wives as Christ loved the church and totally and completely gave himself for her. If you're willing to do that, I would ask that you take your piece of this sculpture and put it into the statue. As we look at the inside of this sculpture, in Genesis 2, verse 20 through 23, the Bible tells us that woman was taken from man. The bride's piece of the Unity Cross represents that of beauty and the many capabilities of the woman, designed with an intricate, beautiful detail. It's placed on the inside because it's under the protection of the husband's piece, completing the sculpture and representing the two become one. Sarah, I want to give that to you. We will place it on the inside.
There's the other way.
There we go. Now, as you can see, these two pieces, they're there, but they're not sturdy. And this is to represent that even though Adam and Sarah can make their best commitments to do what God has designed them, in their own power and in their own strength, they will be incapable of doing such. As a result, there are three pins that will be placed into this cross. each representing one of the members of the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So at this time, I want to invite you to put these three pieces into your cross.
I think it's back.
You missed it.
No. Yeah, it's not. Is it backwards? I don't think it's backwards. Right, it's
done? Yeah. Just put it in, we'll fix it later.
Okay, perfect.
The Bible tells us in Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 12, that a three-corded string is not easily broken. Matthew chapter 19 also tells us, for this reason a man will leave his father and his mother and be united to his wife. The two will become one flesh, for they are no longer two fleshes, but one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no man separate. As you guys finish some of the symbolic things, at this time we need to sign the marriage license. So, if I can have our bride and our groom come forward. Also, our best man and our maid of honor. Sarah, I'm going to ask. Sign right there.
My new name or my name?
Your old name.
What is it?
Adam, I'm going to ask that you sign on top of that. Step down. Let's pray. Father, I come to you right now, and I thank you for this marriage between Adam and Sarah. Lord, I thank you for their willingness to commit to one another, and their willingness to commit to you, and their willingness to do the hard work to prepare for this day. So, Father, now I pray that this day would be just the beginning of a wonderful journey for the rest of their lives. Lord, in the good times and in the bad times, I pray that you would sustain them and remind them of your grace and your mercy and your care. Father, I just pray that you would use them as a light shining in the darkness because of your grace and your mercy. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
By the power vested in me as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I now pronounce you husband and wife. What God has brought together, let no man put asunder. You may kiss the bride.
Thank you.